And good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2024. Colleagues, just to agree as our first item of business that we will consider the evidence that we hear this morning in private later. Are you content that we do that? We are. Thank you. And this morning, our principal item is to continue our inquiry into the A9 duelling project. And this, of course, is on the back of the petition lodged by Laura Hansler, who I see is joining us in the gallery for this morning's evidence. And it follows on from evidence we've heard along the way from Civil Engineering Contractors Association, current and former senior leaders at Transport Scotland, from Mary McCallan, MSP, who was at that point the Transport Secretary before Fiona Hislop resumed her responsibility in that direction. And also, we are joined this morning by Edward Mountain, who is here as a reporter in relation to this inquiry for the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. So thank you for joining us again this morning. Edward is moving amendments at stage two this morning in a bill elsewhere. And so if he gets a jab from a knitting needle to tell him that his amendment is about to be called, he would have to leave our proceedings at that point. Those of you who have been following the progress of inquiry will know that we are primarily focused on what action needs to be taken to get the project back on track. That has actually been what the petitioner and all those who are interested in the A9 project are looking for us to achieve. You know, along the way, I think we've heard evidence about major capital infrastructure projects that are likely to unfold in Scotland over the next 5 years, decade, all of which would be compromised, in fact, in terms of access and ability to capitalise on those projects by not having the infrastructure eventually in place. But we've also wanted in this inquiry just to look back to understand why we are where we are, what led to the delays and at what point these delays became apparent. So it's felt like a very retro week in Parliament this week, if I could put it that way, with John Swinney re-emerging as the leader of the Scottish National Party and our First Minister. A retro look back into the affairs of the A9, and we have giving us evidence this morning. I'm very pleased to welcome the former First Minister of Scotland, Alex Salmond. I recall one former leader, when she revisited events, saying that the mummy had returned. I don't know what epitaph Mr. Salmond would wish to offer for his own evidence this morning, but we're
would
going
you
to
say
move
epithet or epitaph.
Well. Well, I don't know. I suppose either might be arguably possible. But in any event, welcome. Delighted to have you with us this morning. And we're going to move straight to questions, if that's OK. And as we conclude, if we haven't touched anything you think that might be helpful, we'll be very pleased to hear from there. Let me start where Alec Neil came in evidence. And in painting the original commitment to the A9 and his meeting with civil servants, who he said kind of looked at him and said, well, there are lots of other, you know, I know there are lots of other projects that we could be pursuing. Alec Neil said, he said, but this project has one thing that none of those other projects had, a manifesto commitment. And it very much was a manifesto commitment of the Scottish National Party coming into government. And I just wanted initially to understand what your commitment was to the project and your understanding of the credibility of what was being proposed and the government's ability to achieve it.
Well, Chair, thank you very much for your words. I'm very encouraged by this retro theme, incidentally. It means there's hope for us all, perhaps. Who knows? But the other thing I just wanted, I know the committee would want to do this because I've spoken with Laura Hansler. And although we'll talk a great deal today about manifestos and commitments and infrastructure and capital investment, Laura's petition, of course, also concerned the fatalities of the road. And I noticed there was another fatality on Monday night. And the total since this road started to be duelled is now approaching 350 over the last 40 years or so. So I know the whole committee would want to mark the are other matters beyond capital budgets and infrastructure that you're considering, and rightly so. In terms of manifesto commitments, 2007, I think I saw some civil servants before your committee refer to aspirational commitments. Well, that was probably true of 2007, because the commitment in the manifesto then was that the A9 should be dualled, and it was set in the context of road safety. But there was no timetable given for it, and there was no exact formulation in the manifesto. But that really started to change in a cabinet meeting in August 2008, in the town hall of Inverness. I was replicating a UK cabinet meeting that Lloyd George had held in the townhouse at Inverness in August 2021, where they signed the, as you might be interested, know, they agreed to the Irish Free State at that cabinet meeting. Well, we weren't able to agree to a free state in 2008, but we were able to agree that we should publicly state our commitment to the dualling of the A9. And that was brought into flesh, as it were, of the 2011 manifesto, which gave an exact commitment to dualling the A9 between Perth and Inverness. And then, of course, later that year, when the infrastructure plan came forward, led by Alec Neil. Now, I read Alec Neil's evidence, maybe help the committee say I endorse every word of that evidence. It wasn't the only manifesto commitment, I should say, in terms of infrastructure, but it was the largest. And in the infrastructure plan, it was the largest project in the plan, if taken as a whole, of course. And as this committee well knows and will have heard the evidence, that the project was divided into 11 more digestible parts, as it were. But there's no doubt that the Cabinet, my government, the manifesto, the infrastructure plan committed to dualling the A9 between Perth and Inverness, and committed to doing it on the timescale which was introduced in 2011 by 2025.
I mean, obviously, yes. I mean, the two things you touch on there, we will come back to. One is the proposal in relation to a national memorial, because I realise in your lifetime in politics we've seen memorials to Piper Alpha disaster and also to the Lockerbie tragedy as well. So it'll be interesting to touch on what might be appropriate or otherwise in relation to the loss of life. And that, of course, is one of the imperatives that I think drives forward the interest of the committee and others. And in fact, was the original raison d'etre, because when I look at the manifesto commitment from the Scottish National Party at the time, it actually didn't really make reference particularly to economic well-being or the kind of benefit that there would be to the potential expansion in the northeast of Scotland. It made particular reference to the fact that this would lead to potentially a significant loss, reduction in the loss of life on the route. So I think that was a prime motivator, was it not, in the actual underpinning of the commitment?
Yeah, yes, it was. And you're quite right, the 2007 manifesto couched things in these terms. Obviously, by the time you got to the infrastructure plan, Alec was developing a network of infrastructure, of connectivity between the population centres, between the cities of Scotland, and was looking very closely at the economic benefits. But the original commitment was certainly couched in terms of road safety. I mean, the generally, if I remember correctly, the generally in this committee will know, because of the evidence you've had, that the generally accepted formulation is that dualling makes a road about it's about two-thirds safer than a non-dualled road. And I've always thought that the A9, and people like Laura Hansel, of course, have much more expertise in this than any of us do, but I've always thought the A9, because they're parts dualled, parts not dualled, is particularly dangerous in that respect. I mean, when you're driving at night in the A9, you expect to be on a dualled part of the road, even when you're not. And I mean, I'm sure if those of us who've driven that road or been driven on that road have all had experiences of that. But I was in a taxi just over a year ago, a BBC taxi, going from Fort William back to Aberdeen. And the driver, an experienced taxi driver, mistook a part of the road he was on and I thought he was on a dual carriageway when he wasn't. It was late at night. And so that, you know, it can happen, I think, even to the most experienced driver.
I can empathise with that, a similar experience. And I think also, I don't think there can be many people who've travelled on that road who haven't, from a distance, seen a manoeuvre on the road that they've thought crikey, that was really running a risk in whatever it was that they were trying to achieve. And you understand, I think, how people can lose sight of how fast things are moving on some sections of that road and think they've got more capacity to move than they have. The other thing you touched on, which we'll come back to as well, was the fact that this was just one of the infrastructure projects that the government was looking at. I know this because I was the convener of the ad hoc committee that was set up to look into the Queen's Ferry crossing route and the way in which the Parliament engaged with the planning of that process. And we've had some interesting exchanges with the government about whether or not there might not be more oversight of the project and whether or not parliamentary oversight can have helped generate and sustain a momentum, and maybe come back to that later as well. During the kind of this phase, which was very much the pre-planning phase, a lot of what was happening in the initial period, to what extent did you leave that then to Alec Neil and other ministers, and to what extent did it continue to be something around which the government was having a more general discussion in which you as First Minister might have been involved or appraised?
Well, the first term of office, it was more in general discussion, because obviously when you come into office, there are capital commitments that have been made by your predecessors. There's only a certain amount of room in a capital budget. There was also the Queensferry crossing. People, you'll certainly remember with the position you held, but others might not, that the Queensferry crossing wasn't part of the capital budget when we came in 2007. It was only when the difficulties emerged to the extent that they did, the analysis was done on the existing road bridge, that we had to make a decision. And of course, not all of the Parliament were in favour of that decision. I remember the Greens' objection to it at the time. But a decision had to be made, and money had to be found within the capital budget for that very large project. Not as large as the full dualling of the A9, of course. I mean, I think you could get maybe three Queensferry crossings into one full dualling of the A9, but nonetheless a big, big capital commitment. But, you know, I appointed Alec as the Infrastructure Secretary precisely to drive forward the commitments that were made in the 2011 manifesto and in to bring forward the infrastructure plan. I mean, there's a... well, we both know him for a long time, but he is somebody with drive and determination and the right attitude in terms of mixing the politics and the practical, and of course has a business experience, which in terms of dealing with infrastructure projects, I think can be an asset for any minister.
Yes. I mean, final question for me before I move on, and then I'll come back to some of these other points later on. The government that you led, you represented the North East and obviously came from a background in economics. John Swinney was the finance secretary, represented Perthshire and Mid-Scotland. Jim Mather was very much a man who had an understanding of business and economics as well. And that was the kind of economic team that were kind of driving matters forward. But I've often wondered whether when you left office, the government became more central belt centric. Do you think that there was that at any point as we moved forward from your time as First Minister, that kind of spine of the whole of Scotland look at the way in which infrastructure had to be developed became less of a priority?
Well, there were still some survivors from. I mean, I'm looking at Mr. Ewing, who was in cabinet, of course. So I wouldn't overemphasise that, but probably much more that. I mean, I took the as a government coming into office for the first time, and I mean, the Scottish National Party, long and honourable tradition of 74 years, I think, by the time we got to 2007, but I'd never been in government. So I thought it wise, take the unusual step of appointing people to their specialisms. So Jim Mather, who you cite, had very substantial experience in business, so he was made business minister. John Swinney had experience in finance, as you know, so he became financial secretary. So I took the unusual step of perhaps trying to allocate the portfolios on people's expertise. I thought this would be helpful to a government coming in to power for the first time. I mean, we used to say in the army they used to do the reverse. You know, if you were a nuclear physicist, they had you digging latrines and things. Well, I took the reverse view. People should stick to their specialism. So I think even more than the point you make, which I think has some validity, was the idea of putting people to their specialisms. And if you want to drive forward infrastructure projects in 2011, then I can think of no politician in recent memory more adept at doing that than Alec Neil.
OK, I'm going to bring in David Torrance. I should say, I mean, I listened with interest this morning when you were on Good Morning Scotland, being asked similar questions to some of those that were exploring.
It was all about Mr Swinney's elevation. I actually asked him beforehand, is it about the... I hope I didn't preempt anything.
Not at all. No. You posed one of the questions that the committee is trying to explore itself, and that is that at some point something happened, and whatever that something was, we've not yet really been able to properly get to the bottom of what it was, nor was it made public, really, at a point when it must have been apparent to the people who were aware of whatever was happening. And we may come back to that as well, but I'll bring in David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr Salmond. As First Minister, would you have expected to be advised by ministers or officials if the drilling of the A9 was going behind schedule or over budget, and were you advised?
I would have been advised, first by the minister, and I wasn't so advised because it wasn't. So I would not just expect, I can assure you, I would have been advised.
Thank you for that. What do you understand when officials mean the 2025 date for completion was challenging and concerns raised about it?
Challenging, I think I'm right in saying, David, that's from a ministerial briefing of April 2012. I mean, it may have been used elsewhere, but the phrase actually, if I remember right, is challenging but achievable, is the actual quote. Now, I would expect it to be challenging because it's, you know, if you take it as a whole, it's the biggest construction project in Scottish history, so clearly that's challenging. Also, Mr Neil was setting the pace, so it would be ambitious. But achievable, because as Mr Neil told you in evidence, he took the precaution of saying to the officials what is the best possible date that is achievable, and coming up with the 2025 date, and indeed the 2030 date for the A92. So challenging and achievable. I would expect it to be challenging, and I would expect it to be achievable.
Can I ask, were you ever advised that this date could not be met by any officials?
No, I was not.
I have no further questions.
OK. Fergus Ewing?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Alec. In the evidence that you've mentioned, you've read from Alex Neil back in the 4th of October last year, he said that money wasn't the problem. In fact, he said that there was an assessment of the budget that £14.7 million of capital was not allocated to any money, to any project between 2015 and 2030. We are trying to find out why the target of 225 for drilling the A9 wasn't achieved. Was it lack of money? Was it lack of political will? Was it lack of the right companies willing to do the work? Or was it a combination of all these? And as the convener said, I don't think we really feel we've quite got to the bottom of this yet, although we've had lots of useful evidence. When, in your role, when you've described this cabinet meeting that took place at Inverness, can you talk us through who was involved and how the decision was made that the A9 would be given this priority and that the funding was available? Which people were involved in the cabinet? And are you able to say, without breaching any rules of protocol, if there were any doubting voices from any of your cabinet secretaries who urged caution or not? It would be helpful to get that background to understand how the funding issue was seen by you and your cabinet then.
Well, I can't specifically remember. I mean, there were plenty of cabinet voices urging caution right through my term as First Minister. They were quite good at that. Can I put the context, Chair, on the 2008 cabinet meeting in the townhouse? You know, I mean, I've talked a bit about the historical flourish, you know, that was deliberate, of course. But there was also a very serious point, and that is that I introduced the method of taking, or the initiative of taking the cabinet round the country in the summer, mainly, well, not always, but mainly in the summer. And if you take the Highlands, we were in, to my memory, we were in Inverness, Avey Moor, Nairn, Dornoch, where the Daily Record photographed me and playing golf, if I remember it, put it on the front page. I was delighted with the publicity. It was an excellent swing. The Shetland, Orkney, and the Western Islands in Stornoway. In the course of my term as First Minister, the Cabinet met in all of these places. Now, the reason for that wasn't just, because you could have a Cabinet meeting anywhere, you could have it even in these days online if you wanted. The reason for it was to expose the Cabinet to the local populations and their priorities, because the meetings that were attended on these Cabinet meetings, the public meetings, were incredibly well attended and very vigorous. And I thought it would help the Cabinet if they tasted the public from all parts of Scotland. So what happened in the Highlands also happened in the Central Belt, happened in the Borders, the southwest of Scotland, and northeast of Scotland. We met in Fraserburgh once, I remember. So that was deliberate. So is that people, because when you represent a constituency in particular, you can, for understandable and very good reasons, have a very constituency-focused view on the political world. And that helped the Cabinet understand the whole country. Now, the point and relevance here is this. We were embarking on an infrastructure plan which basically involved substantial, huge projects for every part of Scotland, mostly in the public sector, some further in the private sector. But, for example, the Borders Railway, the M8 completion, the M74 completion. When M74 had been waiting to be completed for many, many decades. I remember the guy that showed me, was teaching me how to operate the digger, was teaching the apprentices, and he said his first job as, he was 60, whatever, at that stage, his first job had been as an apprentice in the first stages of the M74. The M74 completion, the M80 completion, which was, and a lot of these infrastructure projects in central Scotland were part of our commitment to the Commonwealth Games, because we had to have the road infrastructure ready. Obviously, the Queen's Ferry Crossing, huge undertaking. The Aberdeen Peripheral Route, which, obviously very close to my heart, as you'll understand. So every part of Scotland, and if you take the private sector, the new ferry terminal in Loch Ryan, for example, would be a good example of a big capital geographical project. So every part of Scotland was getting a project which was much needed, much wanted, long awaited. And therefore, there had to be, in my view, one for the Highlands. So the purpose was of that Cabinet meeting to say, look, this is a Cabinet, a government for all of Scotland, but it's also a government for the Highlands. And it wasn't the only thing we announced for the Highlands. The Highlands and Islands University would be another initiative that was announced in that fashion. But so to me, the infrastructure budget was about economics. It was about what the most important thing was. But it was also a demonstration to the whole country that the Cabinet were operating, the government was operating for the whole country, not for parts of it, but for the whole country. Now, why that applies in particular to rural Scotland is if you merely address infrastructure projects on rate of return or on, for example, a cost-benefit analysis and look at the amount of traffic, then effectively peripheral rural projects will always be discriminated against. Now, the A9 is not a rural project. It's a hugely important project for the Highlands, but it connects the Highlands to central Scotland. So it was to the purpose of that Cabinet meeting was to drive for the whole Cabinet. These were ventures that we should embark on together and defend together and push and prioritise together. Your question, were all Cabinet members signed up? Yes, they were. They were all at the meeting. We were speaking as one. And every one of us, I know, believed that what we were saying was going to be implemented. Obviously, it would have to be implemented in time because of the other infrastructure projects the Queen's Ferry Crossing were engaged in. But that's what happened in the 2011 manifesto. And then, of course, in the infrastructure plan, where Alec Neil brought it all forward for the whole country and made it a firm commitment with a firm timescale.
And you mentioned that you had to implement pre-existing commitments from the previous administration, such as, I think, the trams in Edinburgh, for example, and therefore the capital budget had been, in your early years from 2007, had been substantially committed in advance by seeing through what had been sort of either started or committed to. Is that right?
And which the Parliament voted for, of course. It was, if I remember right, as a minority government, it was our first defeat, certainly our first defeat of substance in the chamber was the Edinburgh Trams project.
Yes.
So just out of interest, and what do you think of the trams now that we have them?
Almost everybody who has gone through a tram project in an older city will have a difference between the process of doing it and the eventual completion. Everybody likes them once they're completed, but the question is, was that the best way to ensure connectivity over that period? And you'll still find many, many, particularly a shopkeeper in key parts of Edinburgh, who will say it would be really nice for my business if my business had survived to see the trams in completion. So, I wasn't against, I mean, nobody's against trams, at least I don't think they are, but my practical doubts about the trams were based on my family experience. My father was the town plumber in my grandfather, rather, was the town plumber in Llanfairpwll. As a young lad, I used to toddle about with his tools. And what I remember more than anything else was that nothing was where it should be. In other words, I remember once the new plumbers coming to see my grandfather and saying, look, you know, where are the drains? We've dug up the road, they're no there. And my granny would say, yeah, we moved them in 1936, so 50 yards down the road. Now, the point is that Llanfairpwll is an ancient medieval town. Edinburgh is an ancient medieval city, albeit an early modern city in the new town. And I was absolutely convinced that as soon as they started digging up Edinburgh, the gas wouldn't be where it should be, the drain. And to some extent, at least if you look at the inquiry, that was a relevant factor. Maybe not the only relevant factor, but a relevant factor in the problems that the tram enterprise had.
Sorry, Mr. Ewing, a digression, but an interesting one just since you were involved.
Getting back to the A9, I mean, Alex Neil said that this was an estimate, I think, that was carried out in an exercise done in around about 2011, that around $15 billion of capital was not allocated, and the A9 dueling project was estimated at the figure for both A9 and the A96 actually was $6 billion. So it was clearly affordable within that $15 billion figure.
The figure he gave in his evidence was he was comforted by the fact that although it was a huge undertaking, it was 40% of the available, that is the free, non-allocated capital budget over that period of time. Now, it is, of course, I mean, if you take the A9 itself, let's take the figure of $3 billion. I actually think it would have been less than that if the timetable had been adhered to, but it will certainly be more than that now. So let's just take it $3 billion as the average. I mean, $3 billion is a huge figure. As I said, it's almost four Queen's Ferry Crossings or Aberdeen Peripheral Routes. But it's only half of the capital budget in a single year. I mean, the capital budget of the Scottish Government, as I remember it now, is about $5 to $6 billion, almost $6 billion. So when you put it in that context, although it's an enormous commitment, it's still affordable because it's part of the available capital budget, as Alec Neil explained. And when you put it into the context of the annual capital budget, you can see even a sum of that size, if you decide to do it, you should be able to do it. And furthermore, this was a commitment over 15 years. It wasn't a commitment for a single year. And dividing it into the 11 sections, I mean, obviously, the sections differed in size and scale and expense, but if you just take them on average, that means it's about, $300 million per section. Again, a mighty sum, but $300 million is not that different from the M80 commitment or the M8 or the M74 completion. So there's no question it was affordable at that stage, and it was set forward as, what was the phrase, challenging but achievable.
So in 2011, this was the estimated cost of both the Highland Roads projects together, $6 billion out of 14. So it looks as if the availability of the capital was not the issue at that point. Can I ask, a more difficult question, which possibly a difficult question is, was enough done between 2011 and the period of the end of your time as First Minister, Alec, in 2014, was enough done over those 3 years to advance the project? What would you say to those who might say that more could have been done during that period? Would there be any merit in such a claim?
No, I don't think so. I mean, firstly, two of the 11 sections were signed off and embarked upon. They weren't started in the construction phase, but they were, you know, signed off in that period. But also, I mean, as you know, in a road project, there's an enormous amount of preparation to be done, land purchase, and as your committee supervising the Queens Ferry Crossing knows, all sorts of legal hurdles and things have to be done. And so that preparation, I mean, and the preparation, the people to do that were appointed in the period. I mean, everything was on schedule. Now, the reason I know it's on schedule is because Alec Lee would have told me if it wasn't on schedule. Once the Cabinet had decided on the infrastructure plan, which it did towards the end of 2011, once that was publicly announced, and then, if I remember correct, in mid-2012, Alec himself made a public announcement in Perth, I think I'm right in saying, which set out the more detail. Edward, you're nodding, so I must be correct.
Finally, you've mentioned, and well, the convener described the business team that you had of yourself and Alex Neil and John Swinney and Jim Mather. Did they all remain absolute supporters of the project? Did the Finance Secretary have any questions or doubts about the affordability or viability of the project at that time during your tenure as First Minister?
Well, John, by nature, is cautious in a whole range of things, rightly so, as Finance Secretary, but he was signed up for this. This was a collective decision in the Cabinet. Many reasons that we did so well in the... I'm talking about when I say we, I'm in the SNP, so I should be clear. Just relax, David, OK? The SNP did so well in 2011. If I had to put my finger on the key one, is we were able to say, not without controversy, but with some justice, that we'd fulfilled 84 out of our 94 key commitments, even though we were a minority government. And if you win that argument with people, or that if you win that debate, then of course people say, my goodness, you know, 84 out of 94 is a minority government. What on earth would they manage if they were a majority government? So it was a big thing to stick to your manifesto. And every single member of my cabinet knew that. So John was signed up for it, as was Jim Mather, as was Alec Neil, as was I. I feel very strongly about this so blatantly or plainly not being kept. But then I'm sure John does as well. Now, if I remember right, John ceased to be Finance Secretary in 2016. Is that correct? Yeah, that'd be the election now. And it may be that once he wasn't Finance Secretary, other priorities crowded in of some kind. But I'm sure now that he's been restored to a position of commanding authority over such matters, he will be as anxious to redeem the commitment that we collectively made in 2011 as you would, or I would, for that matter, because it's a matter of principle, it's a matter of integrity, it's a matter of honour. And I'm sure that that John will seek to redeem it as quickly as possible.
Just one extra final question. If to fast forward to 2024, looking at the situation now and in minority government as of yesterday, with 122 MSPs representing parties that favour duelling of the A9 and 7 representing a single party that opposed the A9, do you see that accelerating the completion of the duelling of the A9 would be a realistic and achievable objective, should the new First Minister so determine?
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Salman. A few of my colleagues have touched on this already, and given the importance of A9, was there any timeline and what was the priority for the government, your government, when you're the First Minister? And my main question will be to you, that did any minister raise any concern that there's going to be any issue with the project?
Well, the answer to the second part of the question is no. And I would have known if any if any minister had concern, particularly the responsible minister, Alec Neil, he would have come to me straight away. I've got no doubt about that whatsoever. And you saw from his evidence, he did not have any concern. And the officials, in their briefings to him, you know, the April document wasn't a briefing to the whole cabinet. It was the April 2012 document. It was a briefing to him. So the, you know, the phrase is challenging but achievable. It's the advice he was getting at that time. In terms of the timescale commitment, that, of course, was made to Parliament in December 2011 as part of the infrastructure plan. But, as I say, the preparation for that, again, as Alec gave in his evidence, was he asked the officials what is the earliest achievable date. I think the committee has touched on the financial mechanisms that can be used to bring an infrastructure project into being. If you go back to 2011, we were very encouraged by the success of non-profit distribution, particularly in the school estate. We were looking to expand it into transport in a way that hadn't been done. I mean, NPD was largely, not exclusively, but largely a school estate matter, and very, very successful it has been as well. So that was one new mechanism was for transport that was being introduced. But, of course, the Transport Scotland, it could claim a number of notable successes. I saw the evidence that was given by the contractor's representative. And obviously he was saying, well, you know, if you look down south and they've got this mechanism. From a government, from a public point of view, I mean, the fact that the Queen's Ferry Crossing came in, you know, several hundred million under budget was a success. The fact that the Aberdeen peripheral route, that the risk had been allocated to the contracting companies, was a success. Of course, you might say in fairness, after such notable successes, which saved the public purse many hundreds of millions of pounds, you might be careful in terms of rebalancing matters to give more comfort. I mean, I like to think that the whole initiative of introducing the Scottish Futures Trust rebalanced the relationship in capital projects. I mean, before the Scottish Futures Trust, the private finance initiative was basically raking the public purse the length and breadth for the country, because highly experienced negotiators and PFI contractors were taking on local authorities and taking them to the cleaners. When we introduced the Scottish Futures Trust, we reversed the balance of power. We brought some of the best negotiators into the Scottish Futures Trust, and they had more experience than many of the private contractors. In all of these things, there always is a balance and an equilibrium that has to be restored at some stage. And that's why I think your exploration of other financial mechanisms to give contractors more comfort is a good one. Because I'm not myself convinced about the guaranteed 3% return, for example. I think I would have preferred to look at the comfort that can be given to a contractor of having an extended period. You know, not have one contract for 3 years, but have three contracts for 9 years, because that brings very substantial economics into the contracting world and the security, which it often doesn't have. I mean, if you think about the school estate, BAM, for example, had a long-term arrangement that meant they could effectively build the same school for the future in various parts of Scotland. And that was incredibly helpful in both the standard of work, the continuity of work, and the cost effectiveness of a capital contract. So perhaps these areas would be worthy of the committee's exploration.
Mr. Gould.
Thank you, convener. I'm quite interested in the dualling of the A9 with respect to compatibility with climate change, and I suspect this might have more relevance laterally rather during your time, Mr. Salmond, but I'm conscious that 07 to 11 Scotland established itself as a world leader in terms of climate change, the Climate Change Act 09 and Zero Waste Plan of 2010, which I was just reflecting on. We're still struggling to meet many of those fantastic ambitions of that particular plan. But I wonder if that theme was questioned during your time in office around how compatible the dualling was with, indeed, the climate change targets which you'd set.
You know, Mr. Gold, I find myself in a very unusual position this morning of, as the Chair will testify, of effectively defending the Scottish Greens from having all of the responsibility for the slippage in the A9 project. I have to say, you know, in most matters, I think the Greens have been the winter and the native pasture of the Scottish Government. Recent Scottish Governments, I think, have been responsible for all sorts of highways and byways which have badly damaged Scottish politics. But in the case of the A9, given that they weren't into government till comparatively recently, I think they don't bear the heavy burden of responsibility. Perhaps on the A96 would be a much more legitimate target. Now, the relevance is this: I've got not no patience, but very little patience for the idea that building a road is something that damages your greenhouse targets. If you build a road and run nothing but electric vehicles up and down it, then you'll keep your greenhouse targets. If you don't have enough electric vehicles or low emission vehicles, then clearly you won't. In 2014, Scotland was 4% ahead of our greenhouse targets with 6 years to spare. We were 4% ahead of our 2020 targets. And the reason for that is we'd made big moves, principally, in the production of renewable energy, huge moves forward. See, if you bring on stream the largest onshore wind farm in Europe, then that has a big impact on your greenhouse targets. I've never been convinced that the way you achieve your greenhouse targets is by nibbling away at, you know, some building in Forfar or something and spending a couple of million quid to convert a £100,000 building. I'm exaggerating slightly, but not by much. That's not the way you get your greenhouse targets met. You get greenhouse targets met by big moves, like the electrification of vehicles to a far greater extent than has been achieved, like the conversion of the natural gas network to hydrogen, like carbon capture. That's how you achieve your greenhouse targets, not by nibbling away at extraordinary public expense and saying, oh, we can't do anything, because, at the end game of saying transport projects are not compatible with greenhouse targets would be for nobody to move anywhere. And even for the Scottish Greens and its current manifestation, that would be a step too far. One thing I would say, in their absence, perhaps we should be lighting up on them. But I, in my early years, in 2007, 2011, of course, had the great fortune of having a Green representative in Robin Harter, who you could rely upon. And rely upon in two ways: to put forward green policies as opposed to whatever issues they've been concentrating on of late in identity politics. So, I mean, that's understandable. Somebody comes forward with a green agenda, you can understand it. And secondly, of course, someone who kept to his commitments, which is not something that I've noticed that Mr. Harvey does consistently over a period of time. And finally, just on the Greens, I watched Lorna Slater's remarks on the A96. I thought it was a pretty poor way to send off a First Minister. It was almost a taunt. Also, it did strike me that this committee might want to have an early, close look at this assessment, which was part of the Bute House Agreement, as I understand it, this assessment of the A96 in terms of green compatibility. Because I may be doing her an injustice, but Ms Slater seemed pretty confident as she was questioning the First Minister that would be a negative assessment of some kind. Perhaps, I don't know if it's within your remit, Chair, but you might want to, understand better the reason for her confidence.
Thank you, Mr Salmon. I just wonder if you have any reflections on why you think the A9 dualling project wasn't indeed completed or won't be completed by 2025.
Well, what does Sherlock Holmes always do? You eliminate things that you can and then you're left with something which must be the case, however improbable. In this case, I think we're going to be left something that's highly probable. I think we can eliminate the various excuses that have been made. Transport, inflation, contractors' inflation. I'm afraid that's part of the slings and arrows of doing anything. That's what happens. That's life. I don't think we could. I don't think we can blame Vladimir either. Either of the two Vladimirs, I think we can excuse responsibility. I don't think war is an acceptable reason. I mean, again, that's part of the impact on inflation. The only excuse it carries anyway, of course, is the pandemic. I mean, it's reasonable to, you know, if this committee was considering a two-year delay in the A9 commitment, I think the government would have an effective alibi by saying we lost 2 years in the pandemic. I think that, in fairness, you would probably accept that. But otherwise, I think the excuses are pathetic. I think basically what you're talking about is priority, isn't it? I mean, politics, the language of priority. So what you're left with is at some point after 2014, I suspect after 2016, when Johnson, when he stopped being finance minister, but I would hope that anyway. But certainly after 2014, I can give you evidence that other priorities became somehow more important. That 40% of the available capital budget that Alec Neil had estimated back in 2011-2012, that other things became important. There is an analogy that the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, which we decided in the first term of the SNP government to do by conventional finance, became a huge part of the capital budget. And I remember the other ministers occasionally, obviously they wouldn't dare to question the health sector directly, but would mumble about that it was such a large part of the capital budget. But once you commit to it, you commit. You don't sort of say, right, we're going to do it and then start moaning afterwards. You find a way to get it done. And so I suspect that other priorities, to be absolutely honest, I struggle to know what these were. I mean, if you think about the capital projects I've mentioned, the ones that were planned between 2007 and carried forward to 2014, I mean, all of Scotland knows there's a Queen's Ferry crossing. In central Scotland, we know that the motorway network is almost complete. You know, there'd be a bit of edging here and there in central Scotland, but, you know, the things are much better than the M74, the M80 with the free lanes and all the rest of it. The Borders Railway, you know, which again had to be done by a conventional capital project, because Network Rail, good example of a central institution not regarding a periphery as important. Network Rail said that the Borders Railway didn't meet their criteria for numbers of passengers. So it had to be done by the Scottish Government and then handed over to Network Rail. And of course, it's exceeded its passengers, I think, several times over. So somewhere the language of priority changed after 2014, and it became less of an overriding commitment. I'm not saying people wouldn't want you to do it, but other things must have impinged on the capital budget. And as I say, perhaps after 2016, when John Swinney left as finance secretary, because I like to believe that he did regard himself as bound by the commitment as Fergus Ewing and I were, and would still regard himself, now he's in a position to, as bound by that commitment. No doubt you'll ask him, Chair.
Thank you. Back to you,
Kevin. On that point, I mean, I've often wondered, parties that make the long march from opposition into government are, I think, as you talked about in 2007, very committed to the manifesto that they fought that got them there. But it has seemed to me in the time I've been involved in politics that governments, the more they are re-elected, attach less importance somehow to manifesto commitments and start to evolve priorities of their own in government, which perhaps didn't feature in manifestos to quite the same extent, and a kind of drift can sometimes occur. And it's difficult because I don't think we've really understood what happened around about 2018, which is obviously after your time, when it looks as if the commitment to 2025 was lost, and whether that was being led by ministers who were on top of the project and realised something wasn't right, and started to introduce, well, are there other ways this could be funded? Or whether it came by officials who started to think, oh, I don't know if this is affordable, we'll have to look at other ways of introducing it. There seems to be, at that point, a lack of grip and leadership. That's the thing that the evidence seems to suggest. And I just wonder whether that focus and drive on delivering on commitments that parties are very concerned with when they come into office, possibly because they are the great projects that they have thought about, is lost the longer that they stay in office. But I don't know how you would reflect on that.
Well, I don't think it's just parties, it's individuals. I mean, if you don't mind me saying, Chair, that you aspired to elected office for a number of years, a number of occasions before you achieved it. That would be the case for the overwhelming bulk of the SNP representatives elected in 2007 and in 2011. You know, these were people who'd, you know, slaved in the vineyard or the coalface for years and years and years, often with no expectation of winning. And therefore, when they arrived in Parliament, in the, you know, the reconvened Scottish Parliament, it was the most amazing privilege, you know, it was the most amazing thing. And therefore, the determination to redeem the commitments you made is very, very great. And it's not a particular comment on any individual, but I wonder if parties get the assumption of office, or the, you know, or people who are on a certain trajectory from, you know, well, it might be a constituency assistant to special advisor to MSP, and so seamlessly up the ladder of opportunity, perhaps have the same awareness that politics is snakes as well as ladders. And so I do think the people who came in 2007 and 2011, not just at cabinet level but party level, were invested with a great sense of responsibility. And that responsibility is, you know, is given manifestation by the manifesto. That's what a manifesto is. Secondly, do people lack, with your business background, you'd be very aware of the totality of what's going on. Now, I've rejected a few excuses earlier on, and leaving with a question of priorities. But of course, priorities are important as well. I mean, you know, I sometimes wonder, listening to people, if they're aware of the full extent of the capital investments that are taking place in the north of Scotland at the present moment, particularly in energy, obviously, but elsewhere as well. And you know, private sector, that matters. I don't want to pick on Lorna Slater again, but I did actually see her in a BBC programme last week. She was asked about the bottle return scheme, and she said it didn't cost anything because the business paid for it, which is the most amazing thing. And that's not true, incidentally, because if you remember, there was a large sum lost from the public as well. But the attitude, you know, that didn't matter because that was business, that was private business. Well, what's happening in private business at the present moment in terms of energy infrastructure is hugely relevant to the capacity to deliver public infrastructure projects. And I just wonder if how early as you know, this has been a hobby horse of mine for decades. Scotland is the green energy powerhouse of Europe, I think. Perhaps you even teased me about it from time to time, Chair. But there's no doubting my focus and ambition on it and requirement for the amount of capital you'd have to spend. So being aware of what else is happening in the world is really quite important, and you'd hope and believe that the Cabinet were, and making provision to have the ability to say that there's enough slack in the system to have enough civil engineers out there doing the job. Now, there's ways to cope with any of these things. It is, by definition, a good thing that there are so many capital projects. There is such a demand for skilled labour. But, you know, that, taking it back, one thing that I like about Alec Neil is he is one of the politicians with the capacity to understand that what you do affects something else, and therefore you have to make sure that the supply of skilled labour by one means or another is coming through in order to further the project. So, you know, I obviously many politicians in this place are fully aware of world developments, but I just wonder if all are.
No, it's a perfectly reasonable point, and I get a slightly shared analysis, I think, of the way these things can drift. Our reporter, Edward Mountain.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. I want to take you back.
Who do you report to?
Well, I report back to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, for which I'm the convener of.
Well, that's a good example of what I've just been talking about. You're a living manifestation of the global nature of these decisions.
Well, I think transport falls within the committee's portfolio, so I think it's right that we've got some representation here.
Sure.
And so I want to take you back to the, you said the middle of June, it was the 6th of June 2012, when Alec Neil went and announced that this completion of the duelling of the A9 by 2025 was the government's aspiration. I'm assuming that you had a cabinet meeting on the Tuesday, so you would have known that he was going up on the Wednesday to make this big announcement.
Oh, yeah. Definitely, but although the commitment to 2025 was made in December of the previous year, Edward.
Indeed it was, yeah. On the 6th of December, but he was going to announce it and use the opportunity to stand on a bridge to make this announcement.
Well, I think all governments announce things at least twice, and sometimes more than that.
Well, my point is that between then and when you stopped being First Minister, you would have regularly requested updates from him at the Cabinet meeting of how this project was going. Surely it wasn't something you just left to him. It would have been discussed around the Cabinet table.
No, the big discussion around Cabinet is for the infrastructure plan. You would only expect, I mean, obviously, the way I ran Cabinet was every Cabinet Secretary had a turn, you know, to speak at Cabinet, to raise anything or to put anything on the agenda. But normally you'd only expect to come back to Cabinet for a decision if something had gone wrong. You know, if something was being blown off course, if something wasn't right. Now, that didn't happen, and as Alec testified before you. So there was no need for him to come back to say, I want you to confirm once again that 2025 is our target or is our date, because, you know, as long as he was on track, he wouldn't do that.
So if a Cabinet Secretary decided to be slow on implementing it, you'd have no way of checking up on it.
Well, I'll tell you something, the words slow and Alec Neil are seldom used in the same sentence.
I'm not suggesting that he is slow, and I've got huge respect for him. But if a Cabinet Secretary was not pushing forward, would you pick that up?
I would have not only picked it up, but I mean, it would have been automatic. I would have been astounded if any Cabinet Secretary wasn't bringing that information to me and to Cabinet.
Because I think what Highlanders don't understand is that there was this commitment that had been made, and we cannot understand where it went off the rails. And you've clearly said this morning to the committee that when you left office, it was still on track and everything was going well. And you're inferring that up until 2016, when John Swinney was still in post, you believe it was going well as well.
Because John was so much part of that decision-making, I would find it difficult to believe that John would have allowed it to slip off track. But you can ask him yourself, and I'm hoping, as I've said a couple of times, that now he has been restored to a position of... I mean, not he's been in a position of influence throughout, but there's a difference between being First Minister and Finance Secretary than even, you know, being Education Secretary or Deputy First Minister. I mean, to a certain extent, you are the receiver of decisions in these latter posts. Finance Secretary and First Minister make decisions.
So there would be no excuse for a First Minister not knowing that this project wasn't on track and wasn't progressing to the target that had been announced?
The relevant minister would, and certainly, look, I can only speak for my cabinet, but the relevant minister would have come to me. I mean, can I just a word, Edward, about, you know, I was thinking, you know, if you asked me, and since nobody has, so probably wisely, you know, what would I suggest in terms of getting things back on track? I mean, just on this retro theme that you established, Chair, well, what about bringing Mr. Neil back as some sort of czar to get these transport projects that he initiated in the infrastructure plan back on course? I think the Scottish Government would do a lot worse. I'm not demeaning the talents and abilities of Elliot Johnson when he's about to appoint. I'm merely saying that, in my estimation, Alec Neil was a great loss to government. I'm still bemused as to why he was lost to government when he was lost, and maybe this would be the moment to bring him back, to allow him to have a role in completion of what he started.
Okay, so my final question, if I may, for 6 years, nearly 7 years actually, the project languished, and no one told anyone in the Highlands that it wasn't going to happen, that the duelling wasn't going to be completed by 2025. I'd like to know who you think would be responsible for that languishing, and I'd like to know whether you think that Highlanders and the people of Scotland should have been told that it wasn't going to be achieved before 2 years before it should have been completed, if that makes
sense. Well, I mean, the primary responsibility to report to Parliament and to the people would lie with the government, well, clearly. There is a responsibility, of course, in all members. I'm looking at Figgishui. I've seldom seen a more determined backbench campaign to expose what needs to be exposed in this project and to demand what needs to be demanded than Fergus has been deploying in his newfound liberation over recent years. So there's responsibility in all members as well. But the primary responsibility lies with the government to tell the truth to the public.
So the First Minister should have told
the government? Well, the government, the First Minister, yeah, the First Minister, and the various transport secretaries. And I mean, like, there is an element to which, well, this committee has a right to allocate responsibility when it feels fit. Of course it does. But I'm sure this committee really wants, in terms of the duty, collective duty we have to the Highlands, to get the projects back on track. And I'm sure that the main objective is not to parcel out blame, but to look for the means and answer questions and the drive and determination to get things back on track, which is why I've offered today that my hope and belief that because John Swinney was so intricately involved in setting these commitments, that he will feel himself duty and honour bound to redeem them.
And sorry, Convener, if I just say that driving up the A9, as Fergus and I do weekly, and all the experiences that you've quoted, is something that we probably experience every time we get on that road, and we realise the danger that it is and why it needs to get back on track. And I actually think the need to get it back on track to save people's lives should drive everyone, because it is a disgrace that we are where we are. But thank you, Convener.
We are, I mean, as I mentioned earlier, that was the most important thing in the 2007 manifesto, the context in which it was placed. I think it would be highly suitable for that. It's the context in which it's placed in what all of us hope will be a renewed effort to see the project brought to fulfilment.
Thank you. Thank you.
A couple of supplementaries, Mr. Ewing and then Mr. Charnes.
Yes, I echo Ed Mountain's sentiments about the safety. I just wanted to take the former First Minister back to something he remarked upon, namely that people may not understand the scale of investment in the Highlands and in Aberdeen and the North East over the next, the planned investment over the next 10-20 years, private and public, in the Highlands, I believe, £40-50 billion over the next 10 years on grid renewables, pumped storage, water, roads, etc. And all of this is going to involve potentially thousands, possibly tens of thousands of jobs over 10-20-30 years. What impact would there be on that, on Scotland, realising its potential, especially in renewables, where the slow pace, the snail pace that we've seen on dueling the A9 and zero progress in the A96, if that remains the case for the next 10 years, then what impact will that failure have on the ability to realise the potential that could transform Scotland's economy over the next couple of decades?
Well, that investment has traffic implications for the A9, clearly. I mean, much of that materials will be transported by sea, but there will be traffic implications for the A9, and that's why, you know, having a holistic view of these matters is so important. I mean, you need a workforce, availability. The workforces have to be accommodated. And, you know, you can, in a much smaller scale, but, you know, you can look back to the great hydro expansion of the late 40s and 50s and what they had to do to accommodate workforces in significant parts of the depopulated areas of the Highlands. And, you know, so the holistic view would say, right, we need people, we need housing, we need skills, need availability of skills and training, not just financial mechanisms, which are, you know, I find fascinating, John Swinney finds fascinating, but also the real stuff, the stuff that makes things possible. It would be a great shame if the opportunity that investment confers was lost to the Highlands, and this opportunity to see the Highlands not just a great city of Inverness, which of course has a vibrant economy, but throughout the Highlands, the opportunity to see a great Highland revival in these things, as opposed to having bottlenecks and the work and the opportunity disappearing elsewhere. And of course it costing much more, which would be one of the other implications to the public purse because of the pressures on resources and people and inflation. So there is a great opportunity, and it just requires the imagination to seize it and make sure that things come into place as quickly as possible.
And Mr. Thomas?
Thank you, Convener. In evidence to a committee from Mary McCann, Cabinet Secretary at the time, the committee head heard that the funding for the 8 June of A9 project was to be a mixture of traditional capital and funding from PFI, PPP funding. Is this your recollection?
Well, certainly wouldn't be PFI funding, not when I was in office anyway. people say, NPD is just like a PFI. No, it's not. It's about 30 or 40% more efficient than your average PFI. You build better schools through an NPD project than you ever did through a PFI project. And I'll go through the reasons for that if you wish and explain the differences. I'm quite happy to do so. So I would have nothing, nor any government I led, with PFI funding. That doesn't mean you don't have access to private finance. Of course you do, but you do it in such a way as, well, particularly that there has to be no dividend on equity, which has been the major scandal of PFI. That and the renegotiations of ownership of stuff, like you have to pay for water up in Edinburgh and Firmley and all this nonsense. So under my government I led, would not be engaging in PFI funding. But a mixture of both traditional capital finance, which can have great advantages, you can move very, very quickly. The Queensferry crossing, how did it come in so greatly under budget? Well, two things. One, because once we decided to do it with traditional capital finance, and because of the financial crash and things that were happening, not very much was being built across the continent of Europe. Therefore, when we came along with the Queensferry crossing project, construction companies all over the continent were extremely anxious to bid for it. So it then came in, whatever it was, several hundred million pounds under budget. So conventional finance can have a big advantage because you can move very quickly to get things into place and take advantages. Now, why is that relevant to now? I've spoken about the pressure on projects in the capital sector in the Highlands. But, one other aspect that's happened recently is the UK government's decision not to go ahead with HS2 to the full extent. Now, there'll be many a construction company who were expecting to be part of the HS2 who were disappointed by that announcement. I think, by and large, most people over the piece weren't that disappointed, given what had happened to the other sections of it, but nonetheless, that is an opportunity. You'd hope that if you were quick in your feet, you'd be looking to see if anything could quickly be done with a construction company who had been planning to be part of that project and suddenly found themselves without an order book. I think traditional capital finance gives you that element of flexibility. You can seize the moment in a way that is more difficult if you're using private finance through an NPD. Having said that, Alec Neil in his evidence made a very important point. He'd looked at the availability of NPD finance over the period, and I pointed to something called the 5% rule, which is kind of a rule of thumb. You wouldn't want to be spending more than 5% of your total budget and repayments and commitments through a private arrangement, through an NPD arrangement. But he pointed out that when he planned this back in 2011, 2012, there was substantial scope opening up in the 5% rule towards the end of the period, from 2017 onwards, something like that. So, yes, you'd expect a mixture of conventional public finance and non-profit distribution, or a variant of it, would always be the expectation. And both of them have advantages, you would have hoped, with a sufficient priority, that both of them would have been available to seize the moment as events transpired.
Okay, thank you. And just a couple of supplementaries that I alluded to earlier on. One is on oversight, and we've talked about the Queen's Ferry crossing. It was motivated by a bill which allowed a committee of Parliament to be very intimately involved in the planning of the access route that would be required, looking at the different types of bridges that might have been available, handing to the government, really, through the process of the bill, a project that they were then able to execute on time and on budget. And within the lifetime, really, of everybody who had been initially involved in the decision to do it through to cutting the red tape, if you like, on the project. And a reflection that obviously this A9 project, however, a commitment that began in 2007 that remains unfilled here in 2024, that we are talking now about potentially being completed in 2035, a lifetime, several times over, of interested parties and those committed to it coming and going and potentially losing sight of the narrative. And I mean, you mentioned your creative suggestion was that bring back Alec Neil and all would be back on track. But I wonder, with your parliamentary experience, if you, because the government have expressed some interest in the engagement that we've had to date, of finding some mechanism where there might be a consistency of attention on the project from Parliament, which might help just maintain a momentum and a focus. If there's a mechanism you can think of that might assist in ensuring that we don't find that even the work that we are doing here is forgotten about in the course of the next Parliament, and a Parliament after that, people are sitting wondering why we've not delivered a project even by them.
The suggestion, Alec Neil, wasn't meant to be flippant. It was meant to be a serious one, because of the scale of the project and because of the scale of the failed commitment. I'd be very open. It's not for me to pursue, but it would be much to be preferable if the government just stuck to its commitment. And if I'd been First Minister and Alec Neil had been Infrastructure Secretary, that's exactly what would have happened. The committees of the Parliament, of course, your committee, Edward, they have the ability to examine as they wish, and you would hope that they were keeping on top of recalcitrant ministers if they weren't fulfilling things. But I can see that, there is something there, because, as you know, the reason for the Fourth Crossing Special Committee was there was all sorts of special instruments that were required, some ancient, some modern, and therefore you needed a parliamentary committee to get them into legislative shape. That's not the same thing with a road project, Chair. But I do think that I think the government are going to have to do something to convince people that they mean it, And they're going to have to do something a bit more and say, see, when we said 2025, my goodness, it was really 2035. They're going to have to do a bit more than that. So thinking about bringing somebody with a bit of business nuisance to help would be, they shouldn't, my view on that sort of thing was, if there was somebody available, Lord Smith comes to mind for a number of roles, if you remember, like the Commonwealth Games. If somebody was available who you thought had the heft to help, then you brought in the person with the heft, because if they succeeded, you got the credit. And if they hadn't succeeded because you hadn't done it, then you'd get the blame. So whether it's a parliamentary committee to say, look, given the failing, an admission of failure, and of failing to keep a commitment, a solemn commitment, would be a good start, as opposed to a litany of reasons, excuses, and some of which better than others. That might be a way to approach it. Mr. Neil's reincarnation, life after death, might be a way to approach it. But something needs to be done to re-establish the faith that people once had in the Highlands in their government, faith that would have been redeemed if I had anything to do with it, but obviously has been lost now and needs to be restored, and perhaps therefore a parliamentary mechanism might be appropriate.
Okay, thank you for that. And my final question is to come back to the second part of the petition, Laura Hansler's petition, to which you alluded at the start, which is a national memorial to the very many people whose lives have been lost. I mean, we had a rather bizarre intervention in our conversation with Transport Scotland, who seemed to imply that we were suggesting that somewhere in the middle of the carriageway that we would have a memorial that people would be driving past, which, you know, they articulated as being a distraction. Of course, I don't think that was the intention ever at all. It was more to recognise the extensive loss of life and for people potentially to know that there was somewhere, as in some of the other tragedies that have been more concentrated, of course, there has been an opportunity in public life to commemorate. Do you have sympathy with that idea, or can you see issues arising from it? And where, if you did, should the momentum for that actually come from?
Well, the momentum should come from the petitioner and from the people. There is something of an analogy. It's not an exact analogy, which, of course, is the monument to those who died in the construction of the Fourth Railway Bridge. It's not been without controversy over the years because it's been difficult to estimate what the correct figure was. And of course, you would hope that in the construction of the new A9, given modern construction methods, that fatalities would be nil. You would hope that. But nonetheless, there is something of an analogy, which, which says, you know, this is a great achievement to finish something, but we should reflect on those who died while it was awaiting completion. I don't think there's any. I think there's something in that. And I mean, obviously, like all of this committee, I've spoken to Laura just out there just now, but over online in recent occasions, I've heard her very movingly express the overhanging shadow of A9 fatalities on her and the communities that she's speaking for. I think it would be an appropriate thing to do. I think thought needs to be just how you pitch that and how it's put forward. But I think if it was done properly and sensitively, it'd be well understood and well worth doing.
Thank you for that. And I started by saying that at the end, if there would be an opportunity for you just to add any final and further reflections before we drew to a conclusion, should you wish to do so?
No, my only reflection is more power to your elbow. And get on with a very, very important piece of unfinished business.
Well, we shall embrace that as our motto. Thank you very much. And I'm very grateful to you for finding the time and being so expansive in your responses in answer to the questions we put this morning. So thank you very much for coming. And I now suspend this open part of the meeting. Thank you.